So welcome to this edition of the Enriching Mathematics Education Workshop. Just begin the session. So I'm going to be the first speaker. So I'm Viswanath. I work here at the Institute of Mathematical Sciences. And I'm going to talk about permutations. So my title is Permutation Pictures. So we'll talk a little bit about permutations and maybe draw some pictures and so on. Let's do a few examples. So I'm going to write down permutations. So because a permutation is nothing but a way of arranging a set of distinct objects in a line. So for instance, find the number of ways. So this is a typical problem. Find the number of ways of permuting the numbers or arranging the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, which are, you know, four distinct objects. I've just called them 1, 2, 3, and 4, arranging these in a line. Right? So that's a typical permutation problem. So what's the answer, of course? 24, right? 4 factorial. And what's the usual reasoning? So we imagine that there are 4 places in a line, and each place needs to be filled by some entry. So what do we do here? The first entry has 4 choices. You can fill any of the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. Then having filled the first entry, you are left with 3 choices. And you are left with 2 choices. And here you are left with no choice at all. So that's 4, 3, 2, 1. Those are the number of choices. And the total number is therefore 4 into 3 into 2 into 1, which is 4 factorial. Right, so that's of course the total number of permutations, as is well known. Now, 24 arrangements or permutations of 1, 2, 3, 4, what if we want to list all of them? So list all 24 of these. So how do we go about listing them out systematically? So how would you list them, for instance? Arrange in ascending order. Okay, so you mean start with 1, 2, 3, 4. That's one permutation. And then?
Fix one number in the
first number you fix, okay. Okay, and then permute these. So how do you permute? What's next in this order?
2, 4, 3.
Okay. And then?
1, 4, 3.
Okay, and then?
1, 3, 4.
Okay, so that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 permutations which begin with a 1. Right, they all start with a 1, and then you change that 1 to a 2 and so on, right? So you can list all the 24 in this way, except, so the thing with this is it's slightly random, in the sense you have more or less picked whichever one came to mind next and sort of worked with that. So if, for example, you're having to list, say, permutations of some larger number, then it's better to have a slightly more systematic way in which you will obtain the next one, right? So one of the easiest things is to list these systematically. Just imagine these were not 1, 2, 3, 4, but the letters A, B, C, and D. Just imagine we are not talking about, we just need 4 distinct objects. Suppose you have the objects A, B, C, and D, and suppose you are trying to list out all permutations of A, B, C, and D. Right? You want to write all of them out. Right? So it's more or less the same thing. You could try doing it the same way. Think of 1 as A, 2 as B, and so on. So I have A, B, C, D, A, B, D, C, etc., etc. But among these 24 words that I can form out of A, B, C, and D, there is one natural order in which you would list them. Right? What natural order is it? Yeah? Alphabetical order. Right? So remember, if I have, you know, I have, after all, alphabets A, B, C, D, there is a natural notion that you have. How would you arrange, you know, 24 words like this? You would just arrange them like in a dictionary. So for instance, you have A, B, C, D, then A, B, D, C will be the next word. So what's next in alphabetical order?
A, C, B, D.
Okay, great. ACBD, then ACDB. So for instance, that would correspond to 1, 3, 2, 4, right? So in alphabetical order, this would come next, 1, 3, 2, 4, followed by 1, 3, 4, 2. And then what's next? A?
A, B, C.
It's A, D, B, C, and then?
A, B, C, B.
A, D, C, B, right? So those are the six. So let's just write one more out, starting with a B. It should look like B followed by?
A, C, B.
And so on, right? So you just list them in alphabetical order. So this is one of the standard and useful things to keep in mind. It's a very systematic procedure by which you can ensure you don't miss any permutation, right? You'll get all 24 of them for sure if you just keep systematically following this alphabetical order procedure. So sometimes called lexicographic order or alphabetical order. So this is sometimes called lexicographic, as in a dictionary. So that's the problem of systematically listing out permutations. So we know how to count permutations. And let's also look at circular permutations. So again, should be familiar. So question, find number of ways of arranging the numbers 1 through 4 in a circle. By which is meant you have a circle and you have four places. And you want to fill these up with numbers, right? So again, what's the total count?
3 factorial.
And how do you get this?
6.
K1 is fixed.
Okay, so imagine that one of them is fixed because, well, if you, so what does it mean to say it's along a circle? What's really meant is that if you rotate the circle, the new arrangement that you get is thought of as being the same as the old arrangement, right? These two are really the same things. So whether you write 1, 2, 3, 4 in this way, or you move them, you put 1, 2, 3, 4 like this, you really want to think of these two arrangements as being the same arrangement. Because it's still, one still has 2 to his left and 4 to his right. The same thing happens here. It only matters who your two neighbors are and not quite where you are seated on the round table. Okay, so this is 4 factorial. So one way of saying it is you can fix one of them. Think of one as occupying the head of the table, and then the remaining 3 can be permuted in any which way you want. An alternative way of saying this is, remember, this permutation is thought of as being the same as this permutation, is thought of as being the same as 1, 2, 3, 4 like this, and it's the same as equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. So imagine there are 24 permutations in all, but there are 4 rotations, right? So you write down all 24 of them for now. Think of them as all being allowed or different permutations. But when in a circle, there are 4 rotations, there are 4 things you can do which will give rise to equivalent permutations. So if I have this arrangement, then the 4 rotations of it will all be now thought of as the same arrangement, right? So that is what arranging on a circle really does for you. So you can argue that the total number of ways is, since there are 4 rotations, so there are 4 rotations. And so the total number of ways really is the following, 4 factorial total permutations, out of which every 4 are thought of as being the same. Okay, in groups of 4, they really lead to the same permutation. So you divide by 4, which is the number of rotations that you get. Okay, and so the answer is 3 factorial. Okay, is this fine? So you think of all 24 initially, and then you look at how many rotations lead to the same configuration. So similarly, there's probably also another familiar problem with circular necklaces. So for instance, the same question, except you now want to think of forming a necklace out of this, find the number of ways of number of different circular necklaces that you can form with beads, with four beads, let's say colors, red, let's start, blue, green, red, yellow. So I have four beads of colors, blue, green, red, and yellow, and you want to arrange these four beads in the form of a necklace. And now the question is, what is the total number of different necklaces that you can form? Is this a question you've seen before? What do you think is the answer? I have to arrange these in a circle. N factorial by 2? So what is N? So what is the final thing here? You want it to be 4 factorial? By? 3 factorial again. Circular permutations. Right? So imagine this is like, see, all you are saying is this is like a circular permutation. Right? I have these 4 beads which I need to arrange in the form of circle. So I have blue, green, so let's just do this. Blue, green, yellow, red, red, yellow. So that's a necklace. And every circular permutation of this gives rise to what you think of as the same necklace. So instead of this, I have, you know, let me write the others also. Blue, green, yellow. One more. So I have these 4 necklaces, but there's actually more. Okay? So imagine a necklace is, well, what can you do to it? You can also sort of flip it over, right? So I have a necklace sort of facing this way. If I flip it over, I still want to think of it as the same necklace, right? Because it's all the same, meaning it could be worn either way, right? So if you flip a necklace, it's still the same thing. So for instance here, I have blue, green, red, yellow. Imagine I keep this fixed and I flip, right? So what will you get? Blue, red remain same. This becomes green, yellow. So these are the 4 rotations which give rise to the same necklace. But then there are also 4 flips. I take each of these and I flip them. So for instance, I have blue, red. I keep these same and I flip this. So green, yellow. So I want to think of this also as being the same necklace as this. Similarly, I have yellow, green, blue, red. I have red, blue. And finally, I have green, yellow, red, blue. So these are obtained by flips, and these are obtained by rotations. So what is the total number now? N minus 1 factorial by 2. Right? So actually it is 6 factorial if you only think of circular permutations. But then there's also a by 2 which corresponds to the extra operation allowed, which is flip. Right? So here again, maybe the correct way to argue this is to say that there are 8 operations allowed. There are 4 rotations that you can perform, and then you can do each of the rotations and follow it by a flip. So there are totally 8 operations that you can perform to any given necklace to obtain what are thought of as equivalent necklaces. Okay? So even though the total number of permutations is 24, 8 of them in groups of 8, they really correspond to the same necklace. So that's the answer. 4 factorial divided by, divided by 4 into 2. 4 into 2. So 3 factorial divided by 2, which is 3 in this case. N minus 1 factorial divided by 2. Okay, so that's about circular permutations. And let's just look at permutations again. I'll come back to permutations of the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's just take an example. So how do we write a permutation? We just wrote out all those permutations. So let me take, as an example, I'll take the permutation 3, 4, 1, 2. Right? So 3, 4, 1, 2 is a permutation. And what do I have? How should I really think of it? There are four positions. Right? So these are the four positions in which I have filled the numbers 3, 4, 1, and 2. Now, let me do the following. There are four positions which I will number as follows. So the position here is, so this is position number 1. So let me also write down below each of these before we write the numbers themselves. These four slots, this is position number 1, position number 2, position number 3, and position number 4. So these things within circles are position numbers. And in each position, I need to fill some number. That's really what a permutation amounts to, right? So in these four positions, let's say I have filled the numbers. The first position, I put a 3, the second a 4, third a 1, and a fourth a 2. Okay, so a permutation should be thought of as really like two things. One, there are some position numbers, and in each position, I need to fill in one of these numbers again. Okay, so an alternate way of saying this is to write it in the form of, so here are the positions or the position numbers. There's 1, 2, 3, 4. There are four positions. And in each position, there is an entry. So here are the entries that occupy each of the positions. Okay, so let me also, these are the four numbers again. I need to fill each position with one of these four entries. And how do I depict this permutation, 3, 4, 1, 2, in terms of this picture? Let me just say the first position is occupied by a 3, right? So it sort of matches the following. So I have the first position 1 is occupied by the number 3. Okay, so I draw a map like that. So second position is occupied by the number 4. Third position is occupied by the number 1. And the fourth position by the number 2. Okay, so what I've done is just matched up these various positions with the various entries that live in them. Is this fine? And so what sort of thing is this? So where do we see things like these? It's a function, right? It's really a function. That's what is meant by this. So I think of the set. So what function is it? 1-to-1 and onto. It's both. So it's a bijection, exactly. So a permutation is in fact just a 1-to-1 and onto function from the set, well, in this case, the set 1, 2, 3, 4 to itself. So note therefore that a permutation is a function What sort of a function is a 1-to-1 and onto function. So it's a, let me call it, it's a bijective function from, in this case, 1-to-4 to itself. Right? So you should just think of a permutation as being a function, essentially. And so there's more that you can do with this. You can sort of depict. So I should really, so if it's a function, let me think of it like this, arrows. So this is sort of one of the pictures that appears in my title. So a permutation can be depicted as a picture like this. And there's more. You can also do the following. You can sort of follow the permutation to see what it does to various numbers. Okay, so given a permutation, one other question you can ask is, what does it do to the various numbers 1 through 4? Okay, so what do I mean by that? For example, look at this permutation that we have just written out. What did it do to the number 1? It mapped the number 1 to the number 3, right? So 1 mapped to the number 3. So I can depict it like this. 1 went to 3. And now I keep following this. Okay, I got from 1, I got 3. What does 3 become? 3 goes back to 1 in this case, right? 3 maps to 1. So, well, the permutation maps 3 again to 1. Okay, so, that, of course, doesn't account for all the numbers. I still have some numbers left. For example, there's the number 2. So, I can ask, what does 2 become? Under the permutation, it goes to 4, and 4 goes back to 2. Right? So here's another picture. The same permutation that we wrote out, 3, 4, 1, 2. So that's sometimes what's called the one line notation. We just write this permutation out in one line like this. This is sort of a function notation. You write the same permutation as a, you draw it as a function. And this is one further way of thinking about permutations. You sort of see what it does to the various numbers. Okay? So 1 goes to 3, which goes back to 1. 2 goes to 4, which goes back to 2. Okay? So this notation is sometimes called cycle notation. Okay? So you want to think of this as being like cycles. So this is like a circle in which 1 goes to 3, which goes back to 1. Here 2 goes to 4, which goes back to 2. Okay? Let's do a few more examples to get a better hang of this.
The composite function of what?
In this case, the function with itself. Yes, in this case, it's identity. Yeah, but that may not be true for all permutations. So let's do the second example. So example B. So let me write out a permutation 3, 1, 4, 2. Right. So this is just a permutation written out in one line notation. It's a permutation 3, 1, 4, 2, and now I want to see it in the other pictures. Okay, so let's try and draw the other pictures. So what does it do? There are four positions, 1, 2, 3, 4. How does it map those four positions to the four entries? So these are positions, those are entries. So what should one go to? 3, right? First position has a 3 in it, so 1 maps to 3. 2 maps to?
4.
2 maps to 1, because, so the way I'm doing it is this is the positions.
2 to 1.
Right? So 2 means in position 2, I have what number? So I have 1. Position 3, I have 4.
3 to
4. 2. Right? So that's the picture now. That's the function picture for this permutation. Right? I've drawn it as a bijective function. And now let's draw it in cycle notation as well. So what does it do to the various numbers is the question. So what does it do to the number 1? What does this permutation do to the number 1? 1 maps to 3. 3 maps to? 3 goes to, so you should now look here. 3 goes to 4. 4 maps to 2. And 2 maps to? 2 maps back to 1. So that's really the cycle in this case. Okay. So here there's only one cycle. So observed in the earlier example, you had two cycles. Right? 1 went to 3, went to 1. So that's a cycle of size 2. Here was a cycle of size 2. Seeing there are two entries, 2 and 4. Here there's only one cycle. And the cycle has size 4. Right? There are four entries in the cycle, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and they go to each other in this way. 1 goes to 3, 3 goes to 4, 4 goes to 2, and 2 goes to 1. Okay? So that's an example. Let's do one more. If I take the permutation 2, 4, 3, 1. So let's draw the function. Positions 1, 2, 3, 4. Mapping to entries 1, 2, 3, 4. As follows, position 1 goes to 2, 2 maps to 4, 3 maps to 3, 4 maps to 1. Right, that's the picture, and that's a bijection, and let's also write the cycle. 1 maps to 2 maps to 4 maps to 1, and then 3. What is 3 maps to itself, right? So again, I have two cycles in this case. One of them has length 3, right? 1, 2, and 4. The other is just a cycle with a single entry, 3, which is just going back to itself, okay? So this is the cycle picture of a permutation. You have, I can have more than one cycle in general. Here, I only have one cycle. In general, there are different cycles. But here's the first observation. No matter how many cycles I have, what's the total sum of the lengths of all the cycles? By the length of a cycle, I mean how many numbers are there. For example, this has three numbers, this has length 3. This has only one number, it is length 1. Okay. So I take all the cycles, I add up their lengths, what should I get?
4.
I should get 4 always, because all the numbers have to occur in one cycle or the other. Right? So if I look at what numbers are there in each cycle, I put those numbers together, the list of numbers I will generate that like that is 1, 2, 3 and 4. Right? So for example here, this has length 3 and this is length 1. So total is 4. This has length 4 already. This has length 2 and 2. So total length is 4. Right? So no matter how the decomposition is into cycles, the total number of numbers in the cycle is always 4. Okay, so here's a question. Among the 24 permutations of 1, 2, 3, 4, find the number. So here's question. Find the number of permutations which have only a single cycle. So we've written one such example, right? This permutation here, 3142, has the property that when you write its cycle picture, you only get one cycle. My question is, how many more permutations are there like that? What is the count? Total number of permutations which have only one cycle. Why? What? Only one? Why? You mean only this one? Only 3142? You won't have only one cycle. So let me just draw this again. That's really what I'm asking, right? N minus 1. So what problem is this? That's really the question. Just cyclic permutations. See, we've just done this permutations in a cycle, right? How to arrange things along a circular table or whatever, circular permutation, sorry. So it's exactly the circular permutations problem. So imagine, what is the question asked? Find how many permutations have only one cycle, right? So if there is only one cycle, what's the length of that cycle? 4. All 4 numbers have to appear in that cycle, right? So which means I have a 4 cycle. So what should that cycle look like? There will have to be 4 numbers in it. One fellow mapping to the next fellow, mapping to the next fellow. This is the final cycle structure, right? This is how it should look. And which numbers appear inside is the question, right? I can put any, you know, there are 24 possibilities for filling these numbers, but note that whether I put 1 here, 3 here, you know, 4 here, 2 here, if I write 1, 3, 4, 2, or whether I write it in a different rotated way, I write it as 1, 3, 4, 2, it refers to the same permutation. Because all I care is what maps to one, you know, what does 1 map to, and what maps to 1. I'm only interested in who is the neighbor on the right and who is the neighbor on the left. Right? So I'm only interested in knowing what is here and what is here. That's all my permutation, that's the only information I have in the permutation. So whether I draw my figure like this or like that, it is the same permutation. It refers to the permutation 3142, right? So this problem of finding the number of permutations which have only one cycle, well, the answer is this is exactly the same as the number of circular permutations. Of 1, 2, 3, 4, so that's 6. That's 3 factor, right? And how would you write them all out? Well, the same thing, right? Whatever you did in this case, you fix one position as 1 and you permute the 3. You know, call this instead of 3, 4, 2, you make it whatever, all the other permutations, 2, 3, 4 and so on and so forth. So just like I have 3, 1, 4, 2, let's write one more example like that. So let me put the cycle, I'll write 1, 2, 3, 4, for example. So here's another circular permutation of 1 through 4, right, which I obtained by just drawing this circular table and filling it with other numbers. Now the question is, what permutation does this correspond to? So let's work in reverse now. What is the one line notation? What permutation is this? Can we figure out what permutation is this? 1 maps to 2, 2 maps to 3, 3 maps to 4. So maybe let's do the function first. Let's write out the function picture, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 maps to 2, 2 maps to 3, 3 maps to 4, 4 maps to 1. That's my picture, correct? I first converted it into the function picture. And then what does this become in terms of permutations? There are 4 positions. These are the position numbers and those are the entries. So in position 1, I have number 2. Right? It's the permutation 2, 3, 4, 1. That guy would also have, that will only have one cycle because its diagram, cycle diagram was exactly this. Right? From the picture, I've deduced the permutation. Is this fine? Any questions on this? So it's this circular permutation business actually appears in many natural contexts. So it's not just some sort of artificial problem constructed, you know, with trying to arrange people along a round table and so on. It appears naturally when you're trying to count various mathematical objects. Okay, so I just do one more counting like this. So remember, I also wrote out, where is that? That last guy there. So recall 2, 4, 3, 1. This permutation had the following cycle structure. I had 1, 2, 3, formed a length 3 cycle. Sorry, 1, 2, 4, is it? 4. And 3 formed its own 1 cycle. Right? This permutation corresponds to this cycle picture, right? Of length 3 and length 1. Now again, similar question. How many more permutations have the same property? How many permutations of 1, 2, 3, 4 have a length 3 cycle and a length 1 cycle? Have a length 2 factorial into 4. Okay, why?
I can choose the single cycle to any of 4 numbers.
Okay.
And the remaining 3 will be 2 factorial.
Okay, great. So notice that this is actually a very nice counting problem. Okay, question is, how do you find all possible arrangements of 1, 2, 3, 4 such that they form? So it's like arranging 4 people in 2 circles. It's not a single circular permutation, but you know, you have 2 round tables. One can fit 3 people, another can fit only 1 person, right? Question is, how can you arrange 4 people in 2 round tables? Then the answer is the following. Well, you do the easy thing first. Let's choose the fellow who will occupy the singleton round table, right? So that entry can be chosen in how many ways? 4 choose 1 ways, if you wish, or 4 ways, right? So I can choose 4 choose 1 will be, or 4C1 is the number of ways of choosing the single fellow. Now, having chosen that guy, I am left with 3 numbers, which I need to arrange along a circle. Now, that is circular permutation problem, right? So, imagine I chose the number 3 for the singleton table. Then I am left with the numbers 1, 2, and 4. How many ways can I arrange them in a circle? Well, I do 3 factorial divided by 3, right? So, it's 2 factorial. So, it's this times 3 factorial divided by 3. This is the usual circular permutation number. So, this is whatever it is, 4 into 2, is it? 4 into 2, 8. Right? So this is just 2 round table problems. And let's also do the last one. The first thing that I wrote out, which is two round tables of sizes 2 each. So what permutation was this? 3, 4, 1, 2, right? So recall 3, 4, 1, 2. The first example had the following property that 1 went to 3, which went back to 1. 2 went to 4, went back to 2. So there are two cycles, each of which has length 2. So again, same question. How many permutations will give you a cycle of length 2 and another cycle of length 2? Okay, so how many permutations have two cycles of length 2? Each of length 2.
Four.
4C2. Why is it 4C2?
Let's say 4C2 for the 1 and the 3.
Okay.
You can't permute it any further, it's just a single cycle.
Right, okay.
Anything with the other because it's fixed.
Okay. So again, same problem. I have two round tables of size 2 each. How am I going to fit my four fellows in it? I first choose two fellows for the first round table. Right? Now, then I should arrange them in a circle. I should do circular permutations with two people. Right? How many circular permutations are there with only two people? It will be 2 factorial divided by 2. So which is 1, right? Two, it's n minus 1 factorial always. So it's 1 factorial, which is 1. I mean, it's also clear. You can only arrange them in a circle in one way. So I choose two fellows. 4C2 is the number of ways of choosing two fellows who will occupy the first table. Right? So this is for first table occupants. Having chosen them, second table gets fixed. The remaining two fellows have to occupy the second table. And now there is no, you know, I can't really arrange them. I can only arrange them in one way, n minus 1 factorial. So the first round table, I can only arrange them in one way. Second round table, I can only arrange them in one way. Okay? But is this correct?
Yes.
Two factorial will be? I should multiply by 2, you mean? Okay, what should you do?
From 4 is selected 2.
Correct.
You arranged.
You need to divide by
2
because you could choose 3, 4 and 4.
Right. No. 3, 4, 4, 3 is not a different choice. You're only choosing 2 people. 3, 4 or 1, 2, absolutely. So you need to, so this is almost correct, but it's not quite correct. You need to divide by a further 2 factorial. Okay. Why should you divide by 2 factorial or by, the answer is this divided by 2. Because remember, both round tables have 2 people each. So the 2 round tables are identical in some sense. Now, imagine that I chose for the first round table, I chose the fellows 1 and 3 first. Right? So if suppose the first round table, so here's first round table for which I chose 1 and 3. And therefore for the second round table, I would put 2 and 4 in it. Okay, this would have been one choice that I could have made. Or for the first round table, I could have chosen 2 and 4. And for the second round table, I will be left with 1 and 3. But these two things are really the same. Because at the end of the day, I don't care about which is the first round table and which is the second round table. I only wanted 2 cycles of length 2. Right? So here, one cycle consists of 1 and 3. Another cycle consists of 2 and 4. I don't care in which order I write down the cycles. So here, the cycle has 2, 4 and 1, 3. These two are actually the same arrangement as far as I'm concerned. Right? If you write out the permutations which correspond to these two, well, it will be the same fellow at the end of the day. It's the same 3, 4, 1, 2. Right? So I need to divide further by a 2 factorial. So there are always these slight subtleties which will come up when there are cycles of the same length. Okay? So you will see this happening a lot. So an interesting problem which I can suggest that maybe you can try later on is try doing this for all possible permutations of the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So here's an exercise. do the same for all permutations of the numbers 1 through 5. So what do I mean by do the same? First, find out how many permutations will have a single cycle of length 5. 4, 5. So a permutation of 1 through 5 can look like this. It can have one single cycle of length 5. Or it can have two cycles. Of what lengths? What are the possibilities?
1, 4, 3, 2.
Any others? Okay, 3, 2, and 2, 3 are the same. See, I only care about what the cycle lengths are, right? So I can either have a single cycle of length 5, or I can have one cycle of length 4 and another cycle of length 1, or 2 and 3. I'll just write in descending order. 3 and 2 are the two cycle lengths. If I had 3 cycles, right? Suppose I want to have 3 different cycles. I mean, not different. 3 cycles. 2 plus 2 plus 1, for example. Any other 3 cycles?
3 plus 1 plus 1.
Okay, yeah. So, sorry, maybe we should write that here. 3 plus 1 plus 1. 2 plus 2 plus. That's it. Suppose I want 4 cycles. 1, 2 cycle and remaining are all 1 cycles. So I can have 1, 2 cycle and then 3 cycles of length 1. And finally, I can have all cycles of. So let's do this. Easiest one I will do right here. Maybe leave the rest for you. How, if I have 5 cycles of length 1, how many permutations can there be which have this possibility? Every cycle is length 1. Yeah? Only one? Yes? Which one is that? Yes. It's just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right? See, every cycle is of length 1. What does that mean? It means that the diagram looks like this. So, 1 is a single 1 cycle. 2 is its own cycle. 3 is its own cycle. Right? So, what's the picture going to look like? The permutation picture. 1 maps to 1. 2 maps to 2. That's it. So that's exactly one permutation which will do this. Okay? And the same thing for, yeah, I mean, it's true even for 4. We didn't quite do it there. But this 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1, there's always only one permutation which can do that. And that's always this sort of, it's not really a permutation. I mean, it's not a rearrangement at all. It's just everybody going to itself. Right? So that so-called identity permutation is the one which will have this all once. Okay, but try doing it for all the others. So it's very, very interesting to see what will happen in each case. Most of them will be easy. When you have cycles of different lengths, it's easy. When there are cycles of equal lengths, for example, here there are 2 ones or there are 2 twos, then there you have to be a little careful about this division that we did. Okay, so you'll have to see that this happens. Now, one other consistency check. Once you have done all this, right, you see how many permutations of 1 through 5 have this cycle, whatever structure, this cycle structure and so on. And then you count the total number of permutations. The number for this, plus the number for this, plus the number for this and so on. Right? You take all permutations of 1 through 5 and see how many fall into this first category, how many in second category, how many in third category and so on. But when you count all of them together, the total sum should be 5 factorial. You should get 120 permutations. So, you see how many are in each category, but the total sum of the numbers in each category should actually add up to 120. That's a consistency check. You can see whether you get the right answer that way. Okay, so I would very highly recommend this exercise. It's very interesting in terms of doing this permutation combination. Okay, so here's another interesting question. So how do we think of a permutation? A permutation of a set of numbers is a rearrangement, right? It's a way of jumbling the numbers. That's sort of our usual intuitive idea of what a permutation really does, right? It somehow moves things around or jumbles them. And so then here's a natural thing you would want to ask. You know, how much effort does it take to put it back in order? Right? So somebody came and mixed up all your numbers, and then you come in and find that they're all mixed up. How much effort does it take you to actually restore the order, right? Put them back in order. So how does, well, given a permutation, how does one go about putting it back in order? So I'll explain what I mean by this. Given a permutation, say the same example we had, 3, 2, 4, 1. Maybe we didn't have this example before. So let's say 3, 2, 4, 1. And here's what I want to do. How does one put it back in order step by step? You want to do it in a systematic step by step fashion. Okay, so restoring order of permutations. So what do I mean by that? So let me just describe this process. So 3, 2, 4, 1, sorry. So how would you restore order to a permutation? Yeah, I want to bring this back to 1, 2, 3, 4. What? Inverse function, okay, that's, so I want a more algorithmic way, by which I mean this. So I'm sure you must have seen these sorts of little square grid games, right? There are numbers in it and you must finally bring it back to this 1 to 15 or something. But remember, what are the moves allowed? You can't, there, it's some jumbling, but you can't apply some big thing like inverse, meaning you can't take 1 from one corner and replace it with a 7 from some other place. What you're allowed to do there are what sorts of moves? Exactly, there you sort of can either swap, you know, just move one step here, move one step down and so on, right? So it's all very local moves. You are only allowed to do small things at a time. So by doing small step-by-step things, you want to restore the order. That's really the way I want to interpret this question. And here, what does small things mean? Well, I allow you to do the following. I allow you to interchange two adjacent entries, okay? So how would you get this back into order? By only manipulating adjacent entries, okay? You could, for example, look at 4 and 1 and interchange them, okay? So but let me just begin from the beginning. You can begin from either of the two ends. So I do the following. I first look at this window. I look at the first two fellows and I see if they are in the wrong order, right? So it's in 2, 3 versus 3, 2. So I will change that alone, okay? So this is in the wrong order. So I swap them. So which means just interchange the order. I made it 2, 3 and the rest are the same. Now I do the following. I've already dealt with the first two numbers. So I move my window. I look at the next two numbers and I see if they are out of order, right? Are they out of order here? Not quite. 3 is smaller than 4, right? The smaller number comes to the left, the larger number comes to the right. So this is okay. So don't do anything. So this step is, well, they are already okay. So we'll just leave it 2, 3, 4, 1. And then we'll move to the next pair. Okay, look at the last two elements, 4 and 1. They are out of order. So I swap again. Okay, so let's say swap. So that will become 2, 3, 1, 4, right? So what have I done right now? I have sort of swept this left once, you know, all the way from left to right. I have interchanged these guys and now I've done some restoring of order, right? A little bit, not entirely. Now I begin again from the beginning, right? I moved my window one step at a time. I've reached the end. So I start again from the left, okay? But notice, by doing this, I've achieved something. Something is in place. So what happened after this one sweep of this algorithm? Somebody is in its right place.
4
has gone to its right place, right? You observe what's happening here is that this process achieves the following. It pushes 4 to its correct place. Because at every step, wherever 4 is, it's after all the largest number. It'll always be out of order. right? If it occurs to the left somewhere, it will be out of order, so it will get swapped. So after getting swapped, if it's still out of order, it will get swapped again, and so on. So the 4, it sort of will get pushed all the way to the bottom, okay? So that's in its right order, so we really need to only worry about the first 3 fellows. So again, I start from the beginning, 2, 3, it's in order, so I don't do anything. So let's write that step anyway, this is okay, so I have 2, 3, 1, 4. Then I look at 3, 1, they are out of order, so I make it 1, 3. And well, I need to look at 3, 4, but I know for sure 4 is in order, so I won't bother. So I'll start from the beginning again. I look at 2, 1. 2, 1 is out of order, so I swap those. So that's 1, 2. And so finally, I'm in shape. Right? So just a second. So I swapped this, right? 1, 3. So this is swapped. Okay? So this is the algorithm for sorting a list of numbers, getting them in correct order, where you only do very local operations. You only do things which involve 2 adjacent elements at a time. So how many steps did this involve, firstly?
4
swaps, right? So that the swap is really the place where you're doing something. If it's okay and you're not doing anything, we don't need to worry. So how many swaps did this algorithm involve? It involved exactly 4 swaps. Okay, great. So let's do the following. So let's see this pictorial.
But how sure are we that this is a minimum number of swaps? Can you think about that?
I'm sorry, what?
Does this the minimum number of swaps that we can
do? If you what do you mean by minimum number of swaps? I only described one algorithm.
Yeah.
To do this. So what sorts of swaps are you going to allow? Are you going to allow far away swaps or only nearby swaps? Only nearest neighbor swaps, then no matter how you do it, this is the only possibility. So you are talking about what if you came from the right, for instance, right? Instead of doing it the way I'm saying it, going left, right each time, you pick any nearest neighbor. For example, you pick 2, 4 initially, and well, that's in order. So you pick 4, 1, and they are out of order, you swap them. And then you pick some other thing which is out of order, swap them. It doesn't matter which order you do it, the answer will always be the same. So actually, that's an excellent question. See, the point is I have described only one way of doing this, very systematically, left to right, sweeping like that. But you can do it in absolutely random fashion. You take any pair of nearest neighbors which are out of order, you swap them. Then, you know, you take another pair which catches your fancy and you swap them. And so on. You do any set of swaps that you like, but only nearest neighbors. As long as you keep doing this, you will always get the correct answer in 4 swaps. You will never need more than 4 swaps. You will never need less. I mean, you cannot do it in less. It will always be the same. Okay? And in fact, we'll exactly see why in a second. Okay? So I'm just going to draw the same thing pictorially. So remember, we had 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm drawing the picture of this permutation. Okay, what's this? 3, 2, it's 3, 2, 4, 1, right? So I'm drawing the picture of 3, 2, 4, 1. So what does the picture look like? 1 goes to 3, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 4, 4 goes to 1, okay. So I mean, my picture doesn't need to have very straight lines and so on, it can be curved, okay? So here's the picture of this permutation. Fine enough, right? Okay, so let's do the following. Let's count. What shall we count? In this picture, how many points of intersection I get between my various lines? Right? It's already an interesting thing because all I am doing is drawing a function. Right? You remember when you draw diagrams of functions, it's just some random thing that some random lines you draw, right? You don't really assign any meaning to those lines. But now, what I'm saying is, let me see how many times these lines intersect each other. They intersect exactly 4 times, correct? The number of swaps required, turns out, is always exactly the number of points of intersection. So this 4 points will turn out it's always the same as the number of swaps you need when you do this algorithm. Okay? It seems rather mysterious the way I sort of portrayed it, but if you just think about it a little bit, it's not so mysterious. What does a point of intersection mean? Right? If I have a point of intersection, what does that really mean? In my graph, I mean in my picture, having an intersection point means the following, that, so imagine there's a number here, there's some number here, some number here, the line for this and the line for that intersect somewhere. What does it mean? This line let me call these numbers I and j. This permutation has the following property, that it maps I, so I is smaller than j, but the permutation is mapping I to a number that's larger than what it's mapping j to, right? So in other words, if I think of it in one line notation, so it's saying in the ith position and the jth position, look at the numbers I have in the ith and the jth position. Okay, let's call those numbers something A and B. So what is A? A is this, B is that. So what is A greater than B or less than B?
Less than
A is less than B? Remember, A is just some number here. Right? A is greater because, see, A occurs to the bottom of B, right? See, these are the numbers written out in the entries list. So in this entries list, A comes after B, it comes below B, right? So A is actually a larger number. So what it says is, whenever I have an intersection like this, it means that in my permutation, the ith position, there is a position I and j where I is smaller than j, but the entry in the ith position is bigger than the entry in the jth position, right? So these two fellows are actually out of order. They are in descending order, even though A occurs to the left of B. Okay, so they are out of order, and somehow every time you have something out of order like this, it will account for one swap, right? I mean, it's just intuitively, when somebody, there's a pair which is out of order, somewhere along the way, they will have to get swapped in order to bring them into correct order, right? So it's just a heuristic thing for now, but somehow swaps and points of intersection being related is not so mysterious, okay? That's something to worry about always, because I'm actually assigning some very important meaning to this intersection points. But what if I drew these lines very badly and made them intersect many, many times? There can be lots of spurious intersections. So for example, imagine, how can I draw the same figure but increase my number of intersection points? Okay, so let's do something strange. Let's make this 4. So what shall we do? We'll make it go up and down and up. What if I drew it like that? Right? Then of course I have introduced many more spurious intersection points, right? And what else? Maybe I could just make the same curve intersect itself, right? So 2 goes to 2, I can just say do a loop like this, then I will get actually a self intersection, and so on, right? So there are lots of very bad things I can do to this figure to artificially inflate my count of intersection points. Okay. How can you reduce? Right, for example, I want to go from 2 to 2, instead of going like this, I go like this, for instance.
I can solve the problem by insisting on straight lines.
You can, okay, so you can sort of solve the problem. So how do we solve this problem? That's the point. So broadly, the moral is the following. How do you put rules? You should say, you should draw this figure in a reasonable way. You should not be unreasonable when you draw this figure. But the point is, we need to make that precise. We cannot just say you cannot be unreasonable, right? So one solution is the following. You can try and solve this problem by insisting on straight lines. You can say that I should only draw straight lines between this point 1 and this some other point, okay? Now, doing that introduces some other dangers. For example, it might do the following. 3 or more straight lines might end up passing through the same point. Bad straight line, but
that will depend on how you write those spacing.
Right. So then you will have to put all those in as well. So you would want to say, okay, let's space those 1, 2, 3, 4 in a uniform way, space these uniformly, align them correctly, and then draw straight lines and so on. But then three straight lines might pass through the same point. It might very well happen, can easily happen. You can easily construct such examples. Then well, it's not too bad, except that now you shouldn't think of this as being a single point of intersection, right? This is actually three different intersections. So this thing where they all meet should really be thought of like this. This one fellow going like that, one fellow going like that. The third fellow, which should really be thought of as doing something like this. So there are actually three points of intersection which have coincided into one. Right? So it will bring with it these problems. So how do we solve this problem? You just write down a set of precise rules. Okay? So there are four rules for how these things should be drawn. Number one, let's not insist on straight lines because it's that much more flexible. It allows you to do more things with these diagrams if you don't insist on straight lines. Right? Then you can draw them in all kinds of nice ways. Also, it brings with it this problem. So step one, rule one is you should only draw your lines within, so for example, this thing which sort of goes around like a skipping rope is not allowed. You are only allowed to draw things within the space between the numbers. So if I have these numbers written out like this, so imagine there are these bounding walls, and all your curves should only lie within these bounding walls. You shouldn't go out to the left or to the right of these bounding walls. Okay, so rule number one, stay within the bounding walls. Rule number two, three or more things are not allowed to pass through the same point.
Would you say the bounding walls being straight?
It's not too crucial. Yeah, it's not too crucial actually. But that's not too serious a point. Yeah, I just don't want these kinds of things to happen. That's about it. So you can put any rule which will prevent that actually. That's about it. So bounding wall being straight is just one way of saying it. But as long as there are some infinite bounding walls, I don't think it's a problem.
No, curvy
is okay, curvy is okay, So, you don't, rule number two, three or more things should not pass through the same point. If it looks like three things will pass through a point, you make one of them a bit curvy and avoid that three things passing through. Make it different intersections. Okay, that's rule number two. Rule number three, no self loops. These kinds of things are not allowed. Okay. That will clearly give you spurious intersections. And rule number four is any two curves are only allowed to meet at utmost one point. So I have a curve and I'm drawing another curve. I shouldn't do these things. I'm only allowed to get them to meet in a single point. Okay. So whenever you draw them such that either they don't intersect at all. That's okay. That you will get, right? Like for example, the 1-3 line and the 3-4 line don't intersect. But this, the line starting from 3 and the line starting from 4, clearly this is a wrong way of drawing it. You should draw them such that they only intersect at one point. But any curve is okay as long as you make it only intersect in one point. Okay? So this is the, these are the rules really. So let me just draw this again. Okay? So these are the rules for how these diagrams are to be drawn. And if you follow these rules and draw the diagram, you'll always find that the number of points of intersection is always equal to the number of swaps. Okay? And let me just say one more thing because it's something you can play with at home, is what happens when you do this algorithm, right? So imagine at every step, I'm swapping, right? So how do I convert this fellow finally to 1, 2, 3, 4? In terms of diagrams, what does it mean in terms of diagrams? So imagine the first swap, what did it do? It shifted 3 and 4, right? Rather, what happened? 2 and 4. Oh, it shifted 2 and 3, sorry. So 1 went to 3, 2 went to 2. And now instead, 1 will go to 2 and 2 will go to 3, right? So I had these two fellows. Let me draw this a bit more bold. So these two yellow lines are the ones in play, 1 going to 3, 2 going to 2, right? So those two fellows are intersecting here. That intersection I'm sort of seeing in this window that they are out of order. Therefore, they are intersecting. So what am I doing in the next step? I am putting them back in order, right? I'm shifting these two guys. What does that entail at the level of pictures? So if I do the first step of swapping and I get this fellow, now what does 1 go to? 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, right? So these two lines, which are like this, have now to be replaced by the following. I just do the following. I sort of erase this a little bit and I sort of send them along the different tracks. Right? So they were sort of crisscrossing like that, going to these two other numbers. Swapping means the following. I just change their destinations. I swap their destinations. So this line, 1 instead of going along this track to 3, will change tracks here. 1 will just go along this track. And 2 will go along this track. Okay? So you see, swapping removed that point of intersection by just doing this. Similarly, for the next swapping, you keep looking at what happens to the next swap. This is 3, 4. Right? So what happened? 2 goes to 3. 2 goes to 3. 3 goes to 4. No, that can't be the one, right? Oh, no, this was okay. So I didn't have to do anything there. 4 and 1. 4 and 1 is which one? So 1 goes to 2. 3 goes to 4, 4 goes to 1. This is the intersection I need to focus on. So I do the same track replacement. So I send this fellow upstairs and this fellow downstairs. See, this is why it's not, it's more flexible to allow curves rather than straight lines. If you allow straight lines, you cannot allow for this track changing. So now this is the new figure. What happens after 2 swaps? If I do 1 more swap, so I mean you can sort of imagine what happens. It doesn't matter, you don't need to do it in order at all. You can do it in any order you want. Any which way you pick, like the question you were just asking me. What happens if I did it in a different order? What you will get is, at that point, you will just do this track mixing at that point. This fellow goes there, this fellow goes here. There's a problem here, well, send them off like this. So you see what has happened at the end. Right? At every point, you have made the tracks do this different thing. And now some funny shaped curves, but 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 3, and 4 goes to 4. Right? So you can now see why, no matter how you do it, you will always get number of swaps is equal to the number of points of intersection. Okay? So these were sort of the pictures that I wanted to talk about for my talk. So I'm sort of already over time. So I'll stop here.